all stand and worship with me. Thank you that we are here in your presence, Lord. Your Holy Spirit is here in this place. We thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit, the power of your resurrection, God, and through your Son, Jesus Christ. We just thank you as we come before you in worship today, that our hearts will be tuned to you, God, and that we'll be tuned to the message that's on Pastor Don's heart, that you would just speak through him, and God, just bless this time. Praise God.
Yeah.
Jehovah Jireh, and I just love you so much and thank you for what you're doing in this church and in this community and what you will do. We praise you.
Good morning once again, church. This week, we are going to begin an exegetical study. We've been doing thematic topics, and as I stated when I did the interview sermon, I love to do both. I love to do themes and exegetical. And we're not going to be parked on Mark for like the whole duration, from now until we finish it. Christmas is coming, we're going to focus on Christmas. Thanksgiving's coming, we'll have a Thanksgiving sermon. Whatever happens, you know, it just helps break up. And that's the way a lot of good exegetical preachers do it. They sit there, they'll go through a book of the Bible, and along the way, they'll break it up with little other sermons so that way there's no monotony. There's no, I know we're studying this week. So you'll never know, unless, well, Christmas, you know. And before I forget, December 10th, Dr. Terry Dorsett will be here to preach. Because those 2 weeks, the second, which is June Light, and our ninth, which will be our family film night, I was talking to Dr. Dorsett, he said, I'll give you a break. But he will be here to preach. I will still be here. But he will bring us the message. So, why should we study the Gospel of Mark? Why should we study books of the Bible? It is to help us understand more of who God is, what God is trying to tell us in his book that he wrote. Now, this is written by, I think, over 40 authors in over a period of, well, over 1,000 years. But yet, from front to back, it tells one continuous story, and that is God's plan of redemption from the fall of man to the end of Revelation, of how he planned to redeem us from the sin and bring us back to him, and then bring us back into the new heaven and new earth that he is going to create. So, prior to us studying, this is kind of interesting. We're gonna give you a breakdown of study of the gospel, and then we're gonna jump right into the text. So, prior to the 1300s, the 13th century, which is the 1200s, there were no chapters or verses in the Bible. You wanted to study the Bible, you were a scholar, you were a student, you grabbed the Gospel of Mark and you read it from page one to page whatever it was. There was no way to decipher where things were. We didn't even have the little headings. Around the 13th century, monks started putting in chapters, so that way there it became easier for us to study the Bible. Actually, then, prior to that time, it was only the clergy and some rich nobles that would study the Bible. In the 1500s, I believe it was either Tyndale or Martin Luther started putting the verses in there. So it was in the 1500s that we got what we currently have. That's why if you look at certain books in the Bible and you're reading chapters, you'll see like a thought ends at one chapter and begins in the next chapter, and you're like, what was he thinking? Nobody was thinking when they were putting the verses and chapters down. It's just the way it happened. So, background on the Gospel of Mark. Mark is the oldest of the Gospels and the oldest book in the New Testament. It is written roughly about 20 to 25 years after the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. So, this book is the one that, like, a lot of scholars have a lot of solid things. It's not the most widely preached from, but it has an interesting connection. It is one of the three synoptic gospels. Now, what the Synoptic Gospels are these three ones right here, Matthew, Mark, Luke. They all tell similar stories of Jesus. Each one has a certain story that they might tell. Like Matthew might tell something that Mark and Luke don't. Mark, the end of Mark is different from the end of Matthew and Luke. And Luke has different stories that the other two don't. An example would be that Matthew has the Sermon on the Mount. Luke has something similar, but people call it the Sermon on the Plain. And when you read it, you see that there's a difference in crowd size. Like Matthew has 5,000, Luke has 4,000. There are these different things that are in there. But overall, scholars believe that Matthew and Luke looked at Mark and said, this is a great thing, let's build off of it. And they told their own stories. Each gospel, including John, John is different. John is kind of, if you ever watched Sesame Street, they used to have a song, one of these things is not like the other, one of these things. John is kind of that, one of these things is not like the other. John is, it tells a very different story, a very different chronological order, and his is more talking to the church in heretical times, and he's showing the glory of God. But each gospel has a different audience that it's told to. So Mark, being the first, he's telling it to the whole church. He's telling it to the church worldwide. At this time, by the time Mark is writing this, a lot of the apostles are being martyred. So Mark, who is one of the first generation witnesses, realizes this, and he says, I need to get this down before there's nobody to tell the story of Christ. Matthew is told to the Jewish believers, and when you read, that's why his genealogy is based on Jesus being king to David. You know, in that line of succession is David. Luke is to the Gentile believers. He begins it to Theophilus, which some people think may not actually be a real person, but it might have been something that kind of is just like a general title to the Gentile believers at the time. And again, John wrote his gospel during the heretical times. That's when the Gnostics were up. The Gnostics thought that they had hidden knowledge, and basically, John was writing to say, no, Jesus was God. He was fully God. He was fully man. There's nothing, that, you know, what you're teaching is wrong. Let me tell you the story of Jesus. And he has a lot of different stories in his gospel. And he even writes it that, you know, if everybody wrote what there was, there would be not enough paper. There would be no room for everything Jesus did in his 3.5-year ministry on earth. So we're going to jump in. This is the area we're going to focus on today. Actually, we're not going to be focusing on 9 through 11. That's going to be next week. But we're going to begin. We're going verse 1 through 8. And this is where we're going to begin our study of the gospel tomorrow. Now, just got to tell you, if you want to bring pencil and paper next week, we're gonna start diving into stuff. There's gonna be some good stuff. If you like to underline your Bibles, and there's gonna be plenty of underlining here. So this is the beginning. It says, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet, behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. So Mark is like the other three Gospels. They begin by going back to the Old Testament. This is linking Jesus to the prophecies. This is linking Jesus to those times. Again, we have to remember that the Bible is one complete story. It just tells us about Christ's redemption. And so when you go back to fall, God promises that Eve's seed will crush the snake's head. And Jesus is that seed. So you go back, you see that Mark is going to the Old Testament, and he's going to show that things are as were foretold. Now, Here's the thing. It says right here, I can send my messenger before your face who will prepare your way. So this is actually a prophecy about two men. Two men. Now we see the gospel of Jesus Christ. You've probably heard this, but I'm going to say this anyway. Christ was not his last name. Christ is a Greek amalgamation of the Cairo, which would be for Jesus' name, you know, as Messiah or the Chosen One. So there are translations now that are coming out where they take out Christ and they put Messiah or the Chosen One in that place. But this is to tell us that Jesus was the Messiah. This is what Mark is saying. Jesus was Messiah and the Son of God. And he goes back to Isaiah because there is a key thing. He's saying, he's writing here, and it says, I send my messenger before your face who will prepare your way. Okay, so this right here, who will prepare your way. This is Jesus. This is Jesus. But who is the voice and who is the messenger? We're going to meet him. That's the very next verse. John appeared baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. In all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. So, John was prophesied. Why was John prophesied about? When we go back, and this is why it's important to study all four Gospels, there are over 400 prophecies about the coming of Christ in the Old Testament, in the prophets. That was one of them. Go back here. This is one of them. This is telling us that Jesus is on his way. One of the signs that Jesus was going to be there was this messenger, and the messenger was John the Baptist, John the Baptizer, which is kind of an interesting thing. John is, as we're going to see, he's a very unique person. So he was a forerunner. What does forerunner mean? Is someone who represents the monarch. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about what being ambassadors for Christ was. Well, this is different. This is in the British monarchy, they have these forerunners. It was actually during the British Empire. They would have these forerunners, and they would go to the countries to prepare the way for the monarch, for the king or queen, whoever it was at the time. And what they did was they would tell people, this is how you bow. This is, you know, if you're a citizen of the British Empire, you have to bow. You cannot look away from the queen. You have to, like this. They would prepare the way. So John has this this interesting thing where he's going to be coming and he's going to be this forerunner because he was prophesied, because he's doing all this wonderful stuff, he's getting his own followers. He has his own disciples. In fact, so much so that people began to wonder, was John the Messiah? Was John the Chosen One? Was he the one that was told was going to come forward? And his disciples in John 3:30, they sit down and they're like, are you the one? Are you the Messiah? And John's like, no, I'm not. Jesus is here, I must decrease, he must increase. And that was what ended up happening with these forerunners when they went to these things. They were almost equal to the king or queen, but then as soon as the king or queen got there, their power diminished. They were just a normal citizen, normal servant to the monarch. And that's what happened. So there is the symbolism, and then also John compares himself in that verse to kind of being the best man. Jesus is the bride, the bridegroom of the church, which is the bride, and he's calling himself the best man. He's like, I'm here, I'm preparing the way, I've got the ring, let's go on with this. He's got this excitement, as we're going to see. He was, like, he had this foretoldness that he even knew in his mother's womb. We'll get there, but even in his mother's womb, he knew that Jesus was right near him. Well, the two hadn't even been born yet. So, now, John has an interesting look, and this is what Mark is trying to tell us. Mark is trying to prepare us that things are about ready to be flipped upside down. Religion at this time had become just this hierarchy. And we see here, this is how John was dressed. It says, now John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and honey. Wild honey. Now, I kind of picture him being kind of like the Duck Dynasty guys. You know, he's got the beard, he's got the straggly hair, you know, he's just wearing what he wants out there, you know, and doesn't care, you know. And he's out there and he's got this power and might, and this is getting the attention of the Sanhedrin. Now, the Sanhedrin were these people that basically they were a hierarchy. Hierarchy of people that ran the temple. And there were four groups in there. There was the Sadducees, which were Sadducees, the Pharisees, the Zealots, and the fourth group that was there. But they all had their people. They all voted in who they wanted to be the high priest at the time. And it was a lot of like what we hear about the political system these days, you know, that you have to have the ins and outs. When you read and study, you find that out, that there was Caiaphas, who was there at the trial of Jesus. He was the son-in-law of the previous high priest. So, and you kind of like, oh, well, how did that happen? You know, there were these little ins and outs that were going on. Stuff we see even today in some churches. But John comes along, and he's not wearing the greatest of clothes. He's not in fine clothes, he looks like a poor man, and yet he has this authority to preach. And this is where Mark is telling us, things are being changed. God is about ready to really bust open the doors, because everything you think you know about God, you don't know about God. Remember Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, my ways are not your ways, neither your thoughts, my thoughts. This is how God is trying to prepare us. He is showing us, Mark is showing us through his gospel, that this first guy, John, the last of the Old Testament prophets, who does not look like anything we'd expect, he's got this power to preach, and God has sent him as the forerunner. Now, in contrast, clergy dress. Now, you see the way I'm comfortable. I've got my polo shirt, my jeans. I know plenty of pastors that preach this way. Maybe they wear a button-up shirt and jeans. I'm not against suit and tie. I don't have a suit coat and stuff for installation. But this is the way things used to be. I want to explain a little bit about the way clergy dress was, to give you kind of background. Prior to the 1930s, Protestant clergy looked like Catholic clergy. Now, how many of you have ever watched Little House on the Prairie? Okay, good number of you. Remember Reverend Alden?
Yeah.
Okay, remember how Reverend Alden looks?
Yeah.
He had the black shirt and the collar. What was Reverend Alden's affiliation? He was Baptist. Yeah, he was a Baptist preacher. Methodists still kind of wear that. They've kind of gone away from it. But up until that time, the two most dominant Protestant sects of the faith were the Methodists and the Baptists, and they both wore black with the white collar, and they looked just like a Catholic priest. What ended up happening was, in the 1940s, during and after World War, people started going to church. Why? Because as the economy had built itself up out of the Great Depression, people would sit down and say, well, if you want to network at church, because that's where everybody goes. It's only been in about, that was probably the last great era where everybody went to church. And so that was the thing. If you wanted a network, you went to church. Even if you weren't saved, you went to church. you wore your Sunday best, which was actually, at the time, Sunday best, people go in like you saw in your little house of prayer. High angles, sometimes he wore a suit and tie, sometimes he wore like he was just off the field. But that's what happened. The network started happening, and pastors stopped wearing, Protestant clergy stopped wearing the robes and the collars, and they started wearing business suits, because that was starting to become the thing, and that's how they were trying to connect with the people at the time. So by the 60s, that's what happened. Now, the way it is it's kind of a mishmash of different things. And it depends upon where you're trying to reach people, you know, who you're trying to reach. Or, we have to remember, Jesus called his disciples. What were most of his disciples? They were fishermen. They didn't have the best of clothes. I'm sure they had tears in their clothes and holes. And some days, they're probably talking to you, and you're like, that smell of fish, you know. But that's the way it was. So this kind of goes back to John. You know, so we've gone down the rabbit hole here. We have to remember a couple of things. Christianity is based on a relationship with God. The Sanhedrin brought their own rules into religion. This is why a lot of people say that they don't like religion, they follow a relationship. But even Jesus calls Christianity, or what he's teaching, a religion. So, just to give you an example of how messed up the Sanhedrin was, they gave rules. So, God gave the Ten Commandments to remember, all right? So, one of the examples, he says, remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Okay? That was an example of God when he created the earth. He did it in 7 days. But that seventh day, he rested. Alright, got himself together. That's what that means. It means, okay, you shouldn't work if you don't have to. And we need a day off from work to rest up and gather our thoughts together. That's basically what keeping the Sabbath day holy is. God created us in his image. He needed a day after working 6 days to kind of just, okay, I'm done. He's telling us to do the same. He knows that we're not infinitely powerful, we're not infinitely wise. So he's saying, you know what, I did this, you need to do this. At the time, there was no church. Alright, during the period that all this was happening. You know, the church is what happens after. But this is what the Pharisees did. They made their own rules up about the Sabbath. Things about how much you could walk. Alright, this is literally the truth. So, basically, what they would do is they would give out this cord, and you would tie it to your home somewhere, and you would walk that cord, and wherever that cord, when you knew you were about halfway done with that cord, that's as far as you could go. And then, if you want to go home, you just follow the other half of the cord. You go back home. It sounds ridiculous, but these are the rules that the Pharisees did. Because, hey, walking's work. That's how you looked at it. Look at this. Not only was it about you can walk, they even started doing more on food. Like, we already know that the Jewish people have restrictions on certain foods like ham and stuff, but they started putting even more restrictions on food. Things that needed to be done to live, you know, so like you couldn't even, you had to basically prepare your food the day before, the night before the Sabbath, so that you could have your food, your time allotted to eat the food, you know, go and get the food out of wherever it was, that wasn't work. But, you know, you can see how this was, oh man, this was just a mess, the way the Pharisees were. This is why John's coming. You know, John and Jesus are coming because they're about ready to blow this thing up. Then we're not even going to talk about lost animals and hurt neighbor. If you lost your goat or your mule, good luck finding them the next day. You can't go out and find them. And if your neighbor's hurt, you better hope he survives until the next day. Because, you know, you can't take them, you can't go, you know, if you have to go more than the way that you have to go to his house as a pyramid call for help, and the physician is further away, you know, that's the way it was. It's sad, but this is how man-made rules got into what God had already put aside, and then it was already tough based on the Old Testament laws, but the Pharisees and the Sanhedrin just totally dumped all this man-made garbage into the rules. And this is why God is showing us that things were changing. It's a simple, simple fact. Now, let's go back. John 7 and 8. This is where we get really interesting. All right? And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." So here's John, and he's basically telling them, there is one, he who is mightier than I. So John knows. John was foretold. John has this mighty power of preaching. He is preaching people to repent of their sins. John's baptism isn't the forgiveness of sins. It is a sign that these people are ready to ask Christ, when they know Christ, for forgiveness of their sins. But John is up there, and he is preaching. He is bringing it out of the park every day. He is up there, and he is just... And people are asking, "Are you the Messiah? Are you the Messiah?" They really thought John was the Messiah. And John knew. John was a humble man. He knew, it's not me, no. Who you want as the Messiah, who you're looking for, I'm unfit to even tie his shoes. And that's why when we get into the baptism, that's why it's even, we see a humbleness in John and Jesus there, because this is the man who John has just said, I'm unfit to untie this sandal. And yet Jesus comes to him for the baptism, for an outward symbol that he's following God's law. Now, again, we have to, this is also something interesting about John, which you have to and understand. John and Jesus were related. Again, John's coming is foretold. John is nothing special. He's just the forerunner. God has given him some special gift of preaching. But him and Jesus were related. They were second cousins on Mary's side. Mary's cousin Elizabeth got pregnant. Her and her husband had struggled to have a child, and when her husband was in the temple, the Lord spoke. The angel of the Lord came down and told him, "Your wife is going to be pregnant, and you're going to name him John," and he is foretold in the scriptures. Now, when Mary goes to visit Elizabeth after she hears this, they're both pregnant. We don't know how far along they are, but John felt the presence of Christ even in his mother's stomach. That it says John leapt. Like he was like, "Woohoo! My cousin is here! The Messiah!" He was excited. Like we should. And that was the thing. So, John and Jesus are related. We don't really get much into that. Because, you know, John's not sitting there going, "Yeah, I'm Messiah's cousin." No, that's the thing. Again, remember, Sanhedrin, family, hierarchy, you know, this whole thing. God's destroying that. He's got two cousins here that are going to change, but this cousin right here is about ready to go home, to heaven. And this one is going to really finish the stuff John's begun for him to do and what God has laid out for Jesus to do. John was a humble man. He knew that he was unfit to do anything for Christ, anything for the Messiah. And yet, he was willing to baptize him. Now, we're not going to get into the baptism, that's next week. But you gotta kind of picture this. You know, John's appearance, he's this messy camel hair wearing, straggly beard, locust eating, dip them in honey for a little flavor type of guy. He'd do well in a survival show, I'm sure, today. But John, who's sitting there, he's got this power that God's given him to preach, but he knows that in a short amount of time, his ministry is going to end, and that Jesus' ministry is going to take the torch and carry it. Again, you have to see how this fine clothes, all that stuff, this is where God was like really tearing open the curtain already before Jesus' death. And he was saying, things are going to change. Because there were so many people following John out into the wilderness that it made even the leaders in Jerusalem take notice. John, wearing the camel hair and his leather belt, that's all he owned, and he's in the water baptizing people 24, maybe not 24/7, but a good amount of time during the day. Just enough so we can find the locusts and honey. And he's preaching. And he doesn't look like anything like we've seen. Reminds me, there's stories floating around on the internet, and I actually know a pastor who actually did this. He went on sabbatical. He was in Brockton. He went on sabbatical. Now, for those of you that don't know what sabbaticals are, for a pastor, a sabbatical can be anywhere from 3 months to 6 months. It's a time of refreshment. It's a time for the pastor to not focus on preaching for the congregation and receiving from the Holy Spirit what the Holy Spirit wants the congregation to hear. It's a time where the pastor just listens to what the Holy Spirit has to say to him. It's where the Holy Spirit ministers to him, and he reconnects with God, he reconnects with his family. Some churches will do it every 5 years, some every 6, 7, 8 years. They do this. Well, this one pastor had gone on his sabbatical, and his sabbatical lasted 6 months. And during that time, he really went on the count. He didn't shave, he didn't get a haircut. He just said, you know what, I'm away from everything, I'm away from everybody's eyes, I'm just going to relax. And he started studying the Bible, and he came to James chapter 2. In verse 1, it talks about the sin of partiality. Now, what the sin of partiality is where you look at somebody who's well-dressed, and you welcome them and everything, but the person that's dressed kind of sloppily comes in, and you're just like, I don't want to talk to them. They're not what I'm expecting. James, who was the half-brother of Christ, he writes about this, and he says, that's a sin. You've got to treat both people equally. They come into the church to hear the word. They are equals. In God's eyes, they are equals. So that's what he did. He really became convicted of this. So, after his sabbatical was up, he called the elders and he said, I'm going to be there to preach on Sunday. But he didn't meet with them. They said, oh, okay, we'll meet with you and discuss. And he's like, no. He goes, I'll call you and give you the order of service, but that's how it's going to be. So during that time, he had grown a beard, he had grown his hair out long. He came to church, he was wearing dirty jeans, beat up sneakers, a t-shirt, and a jean jacket. And he walked in, and he waited for people to come up to him to say something. And nobody came up to say anything. So the elders are looking around. Now this I've seen the pictures of him, you know, before and after. I mean, it was like two different guys. It was what undercover boss should do for makeup, almost. But what ended up happening was this. The pastor, the time came, the worship team had been done, and the elders were looking around. So one of the elders came up, and he's thinking to himself, okay, I'll take my Bible, and I'll open up to what I was doing my devotions in yesterday, and I'll just preach on that. So he got up there, and he was like, hello, church, da-da-da-da-da. And then all of a sudden, he looked over, and he saw the man get up and start making his way to the stage. And he was like, over, and he came on the stage, and he comes over the pulpit. And then all of a sudden, he realized that was the pastor. So the pastor got up there, and as soon as he opened his mouth, his voice came out, and everybody knew that was their pastor. What happened? Everybody wanted to know. And so he started talking, and he said, you know, during this time, God has convicted me about this church. And he's like, we have been comfortable for so long. We have not opened our doors up to everyone. And he went through the verse, and he had them study the verse. Now, today, this church, which is in Brockton, they have multiple churches meeting in their facility. And what I mean by that is they have a Haitian church, a Portuguese church, a Spanish church, a Korean church. I can't even think of all the other ethnic churches that they have meeting in there. But the pastor has since moved on, but that was the beginning of that church's change, because he knew he had become convicted that we look at the outward appearance, but what does God tell us about where he looks? In 1 Samuel, when Samuel is looking for the next king, God tells him, no, I don't. You're looking at the outer appearance. I look at the heart. And that's what ended up happening here. John's heart is this humble, humble heart. This person who loves the Messiah so much, he doesn't care that by blood he's related to Jesus. He knows that this is the man who is going to die for his sins, and he just wants to share that to people. That's what he was called to do. So again, it goes back, you know, he's saying, the one whose sandals, you know, I'm unworthy to tie, he is mightier than I. It goes back, you know, Mark's going to focus on the authority of Jesus. And one of the things that he does, one of the things that Mark shows us is in Mark 10:45, and we'll get there, but Jesus, even with all this authority, Jesus says, the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. And this is the humble attitude that God is asking us to do. God is letting us see that John is preparing the way for Jesus. He was humble and a serving people, while also preaching repentance. When Jesus is going to be humble and serving people while casting out demons. One of the things about the Gospel of Mark is it shows more exorcisms than any other Gospel, which is surprising. A lot of people think John is the one, but Mark is the one that shows, I believe it's 11 exorcisms that Jesus does. Here's a couple of things to take away about John the Baptist. This is who we're focusing on today. He was humble. He was authoritative. Think about that. He was basically the Billy Graham of his day. Up until Jesus came, he was the Billy Graham of his day. He's bringing people to this understanding that they have to repent of their sins. He cannot forgive those sins. That's what Jesus does. Jesus forgives people of the sins. Even while he is here on earth, part of his ministry is your sins are forgiven. Go and sin no more, he tells the woman. And they're like, oh, only God can forgive. You know, they know the religious religious leaders know that only God can forgive, and Jesus as God is forgiven. John the Baptist, his way was preparing people to accept that repentance of sin, to repent of their sins and accept the gift that God was already bestowed on them. So you got to think, this is like awesome. I would have loved to hear John the Baptist preach. He probably didn't smell well, but you know, who cares? You know, he probably kept an audience like just captured the way he talked. So, here's what I want to ask you today. Are you serving God today humbly? It's easy for us to really get captured with titles, whether it's at work or at church. I've been in ministry for 20 years. I've known people that have fallen from ministry because they got so wrapped up in who they thought they were that God looked at them and said, no. Being a pastor, being up here, this is something that God puts a timetable on. And if God wants me not here, he's gonna turn me away at one time. And someone else will come. God wants us to know that we have to be humble as we serve him, whether it's me, whether it's you. His examples are John and Aaron. Again, this mighty authority, this mighty preacher, and yet he knew his place. He knew that someone better was coming. He knew the best, the one, the Messiah was coming. And so he knew in his heart that he had to prepare the way the best he could. That God had given him what he needed to do that, and that's what he did. So we have to be humble as we serve. Have you given up all you are to become less and allow Jesus to become more? Again, going back to John 3:30. John knows that he must decrease and Jesus must increase. And that's what we need to have as our prayer every day. We need to be praying that when people see us, they understand that when we say we're a Christian, we're a little Christ. That's what Christian means. It means we are a little Christ. That means that the only Jesus people may ever see is the one in you and me. So as we are sitting here, we have to do our best to represent Christ. We have to do our best to remain humble and our best to serve others as Christ did. And it comes down, do you trust Jesus? You know, are you so caught up in who you are that if you gave that up, that you would be able to understand that Jesus wants to do more in you? That was something I had to do at one time. I was happy calling myself a youth pastor at New Hope Christian Chapel. And I thought that was going to be it. I thought, I'll be one of those guys that I'd go to the meetings and there was like a 7-year-old that's still running around with the 13-year-olds and you're like, wow, that guy's a kid. He's got some energy. But that wasn't God's plan. God called me to Meeting House Church. And I thought, you know what? I'm happy. I'm pastor of discipleship. I'm pastor of outreach. I'll continue this. You know, I've got the men's ministry. I'll continue doing this. I'll just wait and wait and wait. And that wasn't God's plan. God's plan was for me to be here. And I had a friend, Pastor Tom Idens, who came up to me just over a year ago, in September. And he sat down with me and he said, Donnie, I'm going to tell you this. God wants to work through you, but you have to be willing to give up what you're holding on to. Holy Spirit to open up the floodgates. Just like Scott was preaching there. And so it was. I went on, I told my pastor at the time, who's now my mentor, James Thomason, I said, I need to go on a sabbatical. I need to reconnect with God. And when I came back, I knew God was calling me. I had to give up. I had to sit there and resign my position at Meeting House in order to go and find where God was calling me. And this was it. 4 months later, you who are the members here at First Baptist voted me in as your pastor. And that wouldn't have happened if I didn't humbly follow God. And so, in that example, I ask you to ask God today, where is He calling you to serve? Where is He calling you to act more Christ-like and share with your family and friends and co-workers? And that's it. Have you taken that next step? If not, then today's the day. I'm going to close in prayer a bit, Scott. If you can come up and play a little music. But that is the thing. You know, have you taken that next step? It is a scary thing. I would say God knocked me off with many pegs. And here I am, I'm a third generation pastor. And even that became a title to me. You know, I'd sit there and be like, my grandfather, and my mom's dad was a pastor, my dad was a pastor, I'm a pastor. And God was like, no, you're not. You need to be a shepherd, you need to be doing this, you need to be living the title of titles. You know, and that's why I don't want reverend out there. When we get the sign up later, you know, I'm not, it's a title. God wants us to be humble servants. I am your servant. You know, I might be a shepherd, and I might be guiding you as Jesus' flock, but I am your servant just as Jesus was a servant. So we're going to go to prayer, and I'm going to ask you if you've been fighting stuff. Maybe something's been going on recently and you know that God wants you to be doing something more. You know, maybe you felt that uneasiness, that restlessness. We all get that restlessness at one time. God is calling us to do something and we're fighting Him because we don't want the uncomfortableness of that moment. And then today is the day to pray. Today is the day to say, Lord, just as you sent John the Baptist to make way for your son, I want to be that way. I want to be a forerunner for Christ. Even though Christ has already come, He is coming again. And we're going to be forerunners. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, Father, there is just so much that goes on in our daily lives. There is just so much that we see and we get our eyes off. The enemy puts our jobs in a way, puts life in a way in many aspects to turn our eyes off of you, to make us think it's us that's doing things instead of you. But we know that you are in charge of everything. You control the stars in the sky. You control everything that comes in our paths. You know our lives are just a vapor before you. But you have plans for us. You know what you have designed us to become and to do, Father. So I just pray right now that as we're here, if there's anyone here and you've been struggling lately with every head bowed and eye closed, put up your hand. Let me see it so I can pray right now. Because that's the one thing God wants us to just give it all to. Father, we just pray right now, Father, for those those here that have maybe moved back their lives, Father, to serve you humbly. Father, I just pray that you would give them strength. I pray that you would give us all strength. Today and every day as we live out being your children, being your representatives, being those you've called us to be, Father, as people come into our lives, Father, whether work or home or wherever it might be, Father, and they are lost from you, open our eyes so that we can point them to you. That they'll know that you're not just some made-up story, you're not something that man has been living a lie for thousands of years, Father, like so many want to believe, that you're real, that you sent your son to die for us. And, you know, Lord, we see it with all these other religions, just as Sanhedrin tried to put these rules, making it harder to go to heaven. These other man-made religions do that, Father. They make it harder through their rules, and that's why they're man-made, because you made it simple. Believe on the name of your son, Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. So, Father, we just pray right now as we're here, as we get ready to go into fellowship, in the fellowship hall, Father, give us a good time. Give us a good message. Bring us home safely, Father, and back again next week. And Father, I pray for the offering that you would bless all the givers, Father, that are giving from their hearts, Father. We pray and ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, I'm grace.